also of the African Union. Here he is, President Tshisekedi. You have the floor, sir. We're extremely honored that you're with us here today.
Merci, merci, Professor.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor. Your Excellencies, Mr. Secretary General, Ban Ki-moon, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished participants, above all, I want to thank Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, as well as the GCA, led by Professor Vakoyan, to have brought together these eminent leaders today and for inviting me to share my ideas on a question that is very dear to me and which is dear to the DRC's mandate at the chairmanship of the African Union. Indeed, we are only 2 months away from COP26, and we are only 9 years away from the year 2030, a key year in a number of our climate projections. As you know, 2030 is when the sixth IPCC report predicts that the world could reach 1.5 degrees of heating above pre-industrial levels, i.e. this is a decade before the initial predictions if emergency measures are not taken. Furthermore, 3.9 billion people could work, could live in stressed, in water stressed areas. The coral reefs might collapse, and 100 million further people could fall into deeper poverty because of the effects of climate change. Also, in terms of the threats we, our planet is facing by 2030, Africa could see a drop in 15% of GNP, as well as a fall in agricultural output and an increased risk of coastal flooding. In order to face these impacts by 2030, the African continent will need $30 billion a year to adapt. For the Democratic Republic of Congo, among other impacts, we see agricultural losses of between 5 and 25%. On a world level, the DRC is one of the most vulnerable countries, which means it is extremely vulnerable and not sufficiently prepared to face the effects of climate change. This is the sad situation we're faced with in Africa, and particularly sub-Saharan Africa. Ladies and gentlemen, climate change affects all our development goals. Adaptation must simply be an essential part of all the actions we take to reach our sustainable development goals. 2030 is also the year where the world has committed itself to reach sustainable development goals. It is the year where we want to see poverty eradicated, hunger eliminated, and put water and sanitation available to everybody, made our cities safe and resilient, reversed the tendency of land degradation, and stop the loss of biodiversity. As this is not an easy task, and it is the strengthening of our resilience that is key to meeting all of those goals. We cannot eradicate hunger if we can only eat when it rains, and we can't make cities safe if we don't attenuate the impacts of sea level rises, floods, landslides, and episodes of extreme heat. Ladies and gentlemen, in echo to the call from the United Nations through the slogan, "Leave no one behind," please allow me to be clear. Africa must not be left behind. You will remember that at the high point of the COVID pandemic, all countries showed their will, their collective political will to face the crisis together. They developed plans to which over $20 billion were mobilized. If we show the same commitment, the same political commitment, we can also bring together the $100 billion a year that were promised by COP15 in 2019 and again at the COP21 in Paris in 2015 to help developing countries fight against climate change. While this should have started last year, I hope that we will see at COP26 an envelope of $200 billion for developing countries, without which these developing countries will not be able to fight climate change. On this point, the Programme for Accelerating Adaptation, led by the GCA, and the World Bank and the African Development Bank is a crucial mechanism to make a good use of the $100 billion a year that will have to reach the developing world. This program comes at a crucial moment since it aims to counter the triple impact of COVID-19, climate change, and of the worst recession that the country has known in the last 25 years. The program will aim to intensify and accelerate adaptation by adopting digital technologies for climate and agriculture, a resilience accelerator for infrastructures, and entrepreneurial component to help young people build resistance to climate change, and an innovative financing mechanism. In order to do this, the program seeks to mobilize $12.5 billion on top of the 12.5 already committed by the African Development Bank for adaptation. I will take this occasion to congratulate the president of the African Development Bank Group, my friend, Dr. Akinwumi Adesina, for his leadership, his passion, and his tireless efforts in favor of resilience in Africa. Just as the African Union, I bring my support, full support, for this program approved at the leaders' meeting on climate change linked to COVID-19, to which 30 African heads of state and other leaders participated. The dialogue on the climate emergency linked to COVID-19 was without doubt the greatest assembly of heads of state and government in Africa around the theme of resilience and adaptation to climate change. This shows the importance that heads of states and governments in Africa give to this question. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to reach our objectives, I call all the people here present to support this program financially. The African countries need more resources to fight the threats linked to climate change. And here I want to thank Dr. Kristalina Georgieva of the IMF for her recent release of around $650 million. But I want to draw your attention that only $33 million of this money is destined for Africa, which is too little for our continent. Indeed, we need at least $100 billion more for Africa, as agreed by the heads of African states, President Emmanuel Macron, and other world leaders at the Paris Summit on Africa in May 2021. So I call on the developed countries to make the effort of reallocating voluntarily their rights to the more vulnerable countries, in particular those in Africa, in order to support their recovery after the pandemic and to enable them to reach a resilient and sustainable growth. The African Development Bank, the first financial institution in Africa, will play a huge role in the recovery, the economic recovery of Africa, and it must be strongly supported And it will be able to maximize any funding to increase and accelerate Africa's recovery and resilience. I hope that in future, all countries and institutions represented here will remember this message. The fight against climate change cannot succeed if it fails in Africa. To understand this and to act in consequence is what we want to see happen at COP26. In other terms, it will be interesting for today's event to be a dress rehearsal for November to move forward significantly and to strengthen our commitments towards Africa at COP26 in Glasgow. We'll send a strong signal for COP27 in Africa. Between now and COP26, we must map out a clear trajectory to mobilize the huge resources necessary to support the frontline actors in climate change and keep our eyes fixed on the goal of 1.5 degrees Celsius. Africa is in the front line, and given its great vulnerability to climate change, its future depends on world-scale measures, firm commitments in terms of resources to support climate adaptation. The acceleration program for adaptation in Africa must be an emblematic example for others. The sum of $25 billion over 5 years will certainly not be sufficient to fill the deficit in Africa for adaptation, but it will bring hope. I am happy that the program for acceleration and adaptation in Africa considers other innovating financing modes from public and private resources, partnerships such as the acceleration program and dialogues such as today's are indispensable. However, the commitments from our partners in development, states, foundations, and the private sector are all essential to free up these new financing resources. Ladies and gentlemen, Africa should not be called on to support on its own the consequences of global warming, to which it only marginally contributes. To this effect, I aim to organize an event for Friends of African Adaptation during the World Leaders Summit in COP26, to be held in Glasgow in November. On this occasion, the leaders will be able to show their financial support for the adaptation process in Africa. Indeed, I want to assure you that my firm commitment as President of the African Union to ensure the success of this excellent program, the program for accelerating adaptation in Africa, and that of the remarkable efforts deployed jointly by the GCA and the African Development Bank. I aim to invite the G20 leaders during COP26 to relaunch this excellent initiative. Africa will overcome the climate change challenge. Total funding of the program for accelerating adaptation will give the necessary hope for Africa. Together, let's reach this objective. I thank you very much.